Hi, Berny, and welcome to Entrepreneurcast. It's such a great pleasure to have you with us today.
Glad to be here. From sunny Florida, out of my porch office, surrounded by garden.
That looks amazing. It's a great office. So, Berny, before we get with the business side of things, tell us a little bit about who are you outside of your business, and what do you enjoy doing in your spare time?
Well, you know.
I don't need Google. My wife knows everything.
My wife runs my life. My best friend's my wife. She's president and chairwoman of CEO. I stand for Women Full Partnership. So, you know, I like to fly airplanes. I like to do simple things. We have such a big life where I speak at major conferences all over the world. I advise governments and nations. And so we like a good book and sit by the beach and, you know, just feed the birds and real simple things like nature walks and just being together. So we are real homebodies. We call it the big life and the little life. And we love our little life. We love the times that we aren't traveling or away from each other and we're able to enjoy our home life and all of that. She's the gardener, so she just loves, I mean, she can have hire people to do landscaping, but she pretty much does it all with our boys. She likes doing it, and she is always changing things and putting new flowers in somewhere, and she loves those projects. And so our balance is, our big life is so big. You know, you're at White House dinners, you're at around the world. I'll be in Romania in just the next 60 days, working with the president of that country and the business leaders of the nation. I'm speaking to 2,000 business leaders that are women in India. I'm meeting in Israel with the government and their teams on peace, on new peace plan. A foreign minister said, it's a new plan. It's a new idea. Will it go anywhere? Who knows? I mean, with politics. But I'm saying, you know, we're trying to make a difference, and we have capacity to do it. We're one of the largest lobby groups in Washington for small business affairs. And, you know, our role is to be good citizens of the world and try to help economically, especially, you know, because most of the world is 20% unemployment in the youth group, your age group. And so giving them how to start their own business, how to go into business and create jobs, make jobs, and it solves the problem. But they don't have good training, and the university systems really fall down at helping the entrepreneur crowd start up, in my opinion. And so we have curriculum they don't have, and it's proven and it works, and it makes a difference for developing a very fast track for creating jobs in countries and nations. And so that's a big part of my life. You know, September is working. CEO space is, you know, something we'll talk about, but I'm saying it's become so recognized, and it's all run by women now. So I am pretty excited that since 2013, which is some time ago, it's hard when you've been 30 years head of something to resign as the president. If you haven't done it, you have to get to a point where you can turn it over. And I'm saying, when you do that and you do it, so women will run all the silos. So instead of talking about for 30 years, full partnership for women, your company becomes an example of it. Then when the women ran the company, it went from number 5 on the Forbes list of top 10 meetings, business conferences that you could not afford to miss, to number 1. And it stayed there year after year after year. And it became number 1 on Inc. magazine. It became number 1 everywhere in the world. But the women did it. I should have resigned 20 years ago. It'd be so much better for the company. So I tell you, men, get your women in the boardroom. Get your men, women in the C-suite, because the problems we created as men with our left brain thinking have to be solved by right brain women. They're the ones that are going to clean up the environment. They're the ones that are going to change. And women, if they were leading companies, they would not put toxic chemicals on our food products or leak them into the wells for their children. You wouldn't see lead poisoning in Flint if it was women making the decision. I guarantee you wouldn't. So men, we need to look at what jobs women do better than men and step back. And I submit to you, it's painful for men, but we've screwed it up for so long. I think one of the jobs women do better than men is govern. I'd like to see them in the state houses, in the Congress, and in the White House. And I think we'll have a different world when we get there. So we got to stop being afraid of it, men, and let women step up to the full power and full partnership.
So, Berny, I guess I got my answer. You are the advocate of the world run by women.
Well, I want to see full partnership. I don't want men not partnered in the process. But I think we're much better where instead of our being combative with each other in any competitive way, we become totally in our superpower of being cooperative and collaborative. Then one and one, a man and a woman leading, make 11. I want one and one to make 11. And that's what happens when we come together. You got to get rid of the fear of it. Men have fear of giving up power, but you get more power. When I gave up the presidency, the role of the chairman became the role that presidents of nations wanted to hire and engage. So, you know, I really elevated by letting go. And men have to learn that, you know, nothing is going to happen to you but greatness by letting women come into the decision making.
So, Berny, tell us more about your company and, you know, your business. What inspired you to start it?
Well, I was an investment banker economist on Wall Street, and I had one of the largest brokerage firms in the world. It was publicly traded, and my father got cancer and he ran a big training company. So I started leaving the company and commuting to take care of his training company and ultimately resigned and sold the firm and ended up full-time in dad's training company, which I changed to CEO space. And the tools we had on Wall Street for larger companies were not available to smaller companies. So we started to make those tools available and have a space for the CEO of small business that wants to grow faster. And we tried to make it not a seminar, not a workshop. We thought people were just fed up with going to be in these rooms where they're with a lot of people being lectured to all the time. We have big rooms. We have where you're in a lecture, but it's only about three times in a week. We are an interactive model that began to put meals to make deals, where instead of a booth at a trade show where people spend lots of money to try to get their things to the market and everybody wants to know if they won the new electronic item, no one is really interested in the product or the service. And so at our program, meals create between the presidents of companies, half are women. So it's a ladies and gentlemen club, and they form real meaningful relationships. Because today with this digital that we've all got, the new capital is social capital. Getting your relationships, you can't get them online. You've got to get offline and get in line and be with each other. You got to get offline and get in line to build social capital. You won't build it online. It's too superficial. You've got, for instance, when we're talking even on Skype, there's cue language. I can see your face, your expressions. You can see mine. You know intention. You know if I'm sincere. You know if I'm selling or telling. You can tell. The audience can tell. And so every one of you, you listen. You can tell. You can tell, you know, where I'm at. And so our job was to create the best business to business program in the world where you could get business done You could get customers, you could get new channels, new outlets, you could have access to all the big chains, any of the larger places you wanted to get, you could get done. You could get prototyping, drop cost and manufacturing, have packaging, branding, trademarking, your capital developed, anything you need is right in the superstore of this place. And so as time went by, it became really driven by quality, global, 140 countries, and it's the number one business accelerator elevator. You can walk in the accelerator elevator and push second floor because you want to double your business. In three of these meetings, you will. If you push third floor, you want to go three times your business, it'll take five meetings to get there. You know, we call it three and you're free, five and you thrive. If you want to go to the fourth or fifth floor, the penthouse, and you want to get, you know, five times your business, it's going to take seven of them realistically. We can't have one meeting make your business go up seven times, but over seven of them, which is just a little over a year, we can get your business up to where you could never do it by yourself. So three of our meetings and you're free financially, five and you thrive, and seven, you're in heaven. And because you only pay once to get a lifetime membership, you can come back as often as you want for life for free. It's probably the best value of the market. So that's what we tried to establish. And that's why we're ranked number one in the world right now by Forbes and Inc. magazine, the two hardest lists, most prestigious in business, that we're the meeting that they rank. If you own a business, you cannot afford to miss it. So to get that quality level, you have to keep making your product the best in the world. And so our teams are always doing that. But that September, my wife, that's our lady team, winning all those awards. You know, as I say, I don't need to Google because my wife knows everything.
So, Berny, you know, through entrepreneurial and business journey, we get a lot of challenges, and I'm sure you had a lot of them. What would you say was your greatest challenge, and how did you manage to overcome it?
You know, I tell people this all the time. It goes back about 30 years, though. But I say, look, you're having a bad day. You're getting a divorce. Now, I will tell you, if you lost a child, you beat me. That's worse than what I'm going to tell you. But when you have a bad day, financial bills, the things you're, because entrepreneurs that own a business, we're the biggest whiners in the world. We'll whine all day long, you know, but then we go into our business because our lives thrill us. We live thrilling lives. We love what we do. We'd never do anything else, but we whine a lot. And I tell you, did your best friend indict you for contempt of court criminally? Did they do it on Christmas Eve? Did they do it 5 years after you sold your company? And did they charge you with $87,000, which isn't even a jailable offense? And did they make it a crime? And did they prosecute you, just set you up so hard, and then put you in chain gang Alabama and put you in a federal penitentiary and places and doing things you can't even imagine with a population you can't even, a movie wouldn't even tell you. So if there are, you know, do you have federal marshals outside your front door and they've got, you know, leg irons and belly chains to take you away? Because if they're not there, you're having a great day. You don't have anything to whine about. You're having a great day. I'm here to tell you. And when you overcome that, you become globally advising nations. You have best-selling books. You have movies made about your life. Go to lsapublishing.com and you'll see the movie trailer, lsapublishing.com. And you'll see the most famous people in the world that you read and go to seminars and go talk to telling you about that story right there on films. and you'll see that nothing I'm saying right now is overstated, exaggerated, or inaccurate. So I tell you, the greatest leaders in the world have had the challenges. Gandhi was in jail 7 times for treason a good part of his life. Mandela was in jail. I knew Mandela. My dad knew Gandhi, but, you know, Mandela was in jail 27 years. President Zuma, who, you know, was a later president, was in jail for years with Mandela. And I'm saying, I just point out that leaders can be very unfairly interrupted, and they never stop their goodness. You know, when Mandela got out, he did a resolution program. You know, I work for world peace and cooperation versus competition. And so, you know, it's just never get upset that if you see good people going to prison, then think we need to reform our system. We need to make our system better. So I, you know, in making the movie, I made the movie so people would get one message. Are you more or are you less afraid of your own government than you were 10 years ago? If you're more afraid of your own government, and I know for millions that have young children and they have the slogan, I can't breathe. I can't breathe. Because a policeman chokeholded the young teenager who was doing nothing wrong to death when he was screaming, I can't breathe. I can't breathe. Folks, we need to change the system. And then these things are going to be reduced. You'll never get rid of all of them, but we can have a better system. So once every 100 years or so, you know, you need to redo your system. And so we need some justice reform to make America the country everybody thinks of as hope and promise. Let me give you an example. Do you think that our country should be the country in the whole world of 200 some nations that is the number one incarceration, that we have more people incarcerated per 100 than China and Somalia, by far? What's wrong with that? The fastest growing city in this country are prisons. Millions locked up, mostly for no victim, no violence. No victim, no violence, just minor drug and alcohol offenses. Mostly pot, which is legal in a growing number of states, the majority of states. But people have 11, 20-year sentences for it, for pot, for smoking a doobie. And I'm saying, in America. And I'm saying, we're spending all the money. We can't even afford it. Next to the Department of Defense, it's becoming the biggest cost. Let me give you an example. In the last 10 years, the cost of incarceration rose 127%. The cost of education rose 21%. So we're spending in the majority of states now more money on incarceration than we spend on higher education. Frankly, I'd rather most of those doobie heads were in college. I think it would help the country a lot more than putting them in prison. So, but you guys do what you want to do, but I think this is the wrong trend. So I wish the numbers were more out there for everybody. But yes, which was my worst day. And I tell everybody out there, you're having such a good day. There are no federal marshals out of your door. And in countries all over, they just want what, you know, they want a rule of law where no one will come get them at 3 in the morning. You have that, you know, just relax, enjoy your country and stop whining and start winning.
So, you know, that story you said with the marshals outside, is that your story?
Of course, that's my story.
So that's what happened to you, right?
Well, not only happened, just remember the prosecutor is your best friend since age 4 in Catholic schools all the way through Marin Catholic High. And I went on to become an economist investment banker. And he went to Stanford and graduated and went to work for very little bit of money at the prosecutor office when he could have worked for a law firm and made half a million a year because he graduated magna cum laude. But he wanted to be a prosecutor. And now he's going to retire all these years later, and he wants to beat his old friend. He wants to win. And so he makes his mark to do it and sets it up so you couldn't win if you tried. And, you know, I wouldn't plead guilty. I wouldn't say I did something I did not do. If they won by having a terrible trial that they made sure they were going to win. I mean, this is the most powerful government in the world. When you fight them and you're alone, I'll tell you, let me tell you, when you're sitting there and there's 100 people on one side, the FBI, remember, this is a small little case. It's the smallest federal violation. It's a small amount. In my business, investment banking, if you're not indicted for $100 million, it's not even respectable. $87,000, that's parking meter money. And so they're across the aisle and just enjoying this case against this giant against, you know, it's Goliath against David. I'm over there with three people, just empty benches. And there's a walnut semicircular area where the bailiff sits. Then the chief clerk of the court sits above that. Then there's another tier of walnut that's above that. That's where the judge will go. Then 100 feet going up is marble. And halfway in the middle of it is the seal of the United States Justice Department. And when they clam that thing down and that judge is in there, and the bailiff is hitting it, and the clerk is calling CF 97-6-54-7-1-3-2. The attorney on the left side is a table filled with attorneys. On my side is one attorney who's court appointed. And they say, the United States of America versus Bernard Dohrmann. Will the defendant please rise and approach the bench? If you think in that walk you're innocent till proven guilty, think again. That setup is so different than our country when it started, when you were in your own neighborhood and a group of your friends was on the jury. That's your peers that knew you and grew up with you, and they don't like the government. And a circuit judge came in on a buggy and he stayed in a hotel and came over and held the court. And if they didn't present a case that was absolute, then you went home. Today, that jury assumes you're guilty if they even brought the charge. And they're sitting in there thinking that central government is, you know, like the 12 apostles following Christ. And they don't intend to do anything, but you know, you have to do something to overcome it that's so fantastic, or you're going down. That's why their conviction rate is 97%. They have a 3% OJ reversal. And when you get an OJ reversal, you better have a lot of money, millions. Well, say you had money, didn't you? Well, sure, I went through many attorneys, and then I ran out of money. And then I had to have court-appointed counsel, because the case went on for years. Say, how many years did it go on? Through appeals and everything, it was almost 7 years of your life in one, you know, horror movie.
Wow.
And your best friend enjoying the heck of it. When I was convicted, which I wasn't surprised of because there was no way to win with this case, the I mean, they leaned back when the court started and the head prosecutor turned to me and he goes, no mercy, no mercy, because I wouldn't plead. And then when they convicted, my best friend came in and he's staring right at me. But people are coming from that big group that I talked about and shaking his hand. They'd flown in, prosecutors from Missouri, from Denver. They're going, you got Berny. Congratulations. You got Berny. they're all going to a warm meal and have a nice hot steak dinner and celebrate glasses of wine, and I'll be going to a federal institution. And I was praying for his forgiveness. I was praying that God would make him whole and that all my pain would be his joy. And I really prayed for that because, you know, I don't hate him. It's just the way he is. He just is that way. And so, and I, you know, lots of good people have had bad days like that. And I wasn't going to let it bother me. When I was in a prison, they used to say, I used to have lines clear around out of sight of people I never met, Crips, Bloods, people from the gangs. And the guards would say, Mr. Dohrmann will coach tomorrow, gentlemen. It's lights out now. And they'd have to go back to their cell blocks. But I was coaching them on their daughter staying away from a crack house, trying to keep their marriage together during this sentence they had, how to support their son who was taking a bad turn, and how to influence them in the proper way. And I just started doing it, and then everybody came to me. I taught entrepreneur classes on how they could go into business, and they were sold out 6 months ahead. You couldn't get into them. And I did that as a volunteer on my own time. And, you know, I just, I wanted it to be some place that I gave back massively to. And I learned a lot of compassion because I was wealthy with governesses, maids. I grew up in a special environment like a movie. To be where people were from the projects, it's not a movie now. You know, it's like I never saw heroin taken except in a movie. Now in prison, you see it. It's happening. And, you know, you see the consequences of it and what the toll is. You see people die of it. And you begin to have a compassion for these fatherless homes, these people that have not been brought up. In other words, not only do we need justice reform, but we need to take the inner cities and really massively reconstruct the model. So low-cost housing shouldn't be make a ghetto. Low-cost housing should be unbundle those projects, unbundle over 25, 30 years, and put people in all sorts of places where when they go to the park and their children are on a swing, they can get a job. They can meet people because it's all about social capital. Don't put them in social capital. It makes a problem worse. Put them in social capital. It makes a problem better. And you can really help lift them up by creating jobs by unbundling the projects. And I think that's the next mission for our government. That's the reformation of HUD. So there are a lot of people working on that, but we got to cut through because the people I know that are doing that, to do it in New York, one guy is getting approval next year to start construction. It took him 15 years to get those approvals. We got to do better than 15 years trapping them in the ghettos of the century. We got to do better for these distressed families. And I'm saying, so, you know, it's our fault. It's society's fault. And I really think there's a way out of this, and we ought to put the money and the effort to do it because we're a compassionate nation. I mean, you say, well, we can't afford it. What they steal from us every day in Afghanistan and Pakistan would reform all our cities. What they steal from us every day would reform all our cities. Just the waste of two nations stealing from us.
So, Berny, on the bright side of things.
You got me on my soap opera now. This is what I talk about when I'm in foreign nations with heads of state.
Even though I think, you know, after what you went through, overcoming all of that and building such a great company and being so recognized, I mean, anyone who listens today, I think, should really realize and understand that all the little challenges that we have in life, you know, and all those little things, they're nothing really compared to some of the stuff that like people like you had to go through. But on the bright side of things, what would you say was your greatest success What are you
Well,
most proud of, really?
I mean, when you talk about being in your young 20s, having five companies, the smallest did 5 million a month, and the largest did 50 million a month, when gasoline was under 50 cents. So those numbers are more like a billion. And then we built the really big companies, publicly traded Smith Barney-like company all over the world, investment banking house, and running that with your own fleets of jets. Where do you go up from there? Running one of the top at the source of money in the inside club of the investment bankers of the world. And then you create the number one entrepreneur training and support system for business that is smaller. But some of our clients are billionaires with 5,000 employees. So we have lots of very big businesses in the small businesses. They're just not fortune companies. We have a growing number of fortune companies send their management to our program. We're in 140 countries. We're now
Wow.
working with heads of state where they want to put this program on every year in cities all over their country to get their entrepreneur developed, to get their tax base developed, to get their own revenues developed. And so where do you go from that? I mean, so if you say, what are your things you I'm a best-selling author, I'm a movie producer. I have my name on lots of films and movies. So in the art side, I have been at the top of the arts. I'm part of the biggest new studio that's launching in the world, CLC Studios, that is going to change broadcast and film and art forever. I'm so excited about that, to give families a product they can enjoy and that will have family values and not sex and violence and still have great words and great stories so children and parents can watch together. And I just, I feel that, I'm doing what I want to do. I'm helping the heads of nations. I guess if you look at the movie they're making about my life, it's really tells the story, which is if your life reaches a point where you're still alive and they're making a movie about it, your life is a movie. So, I mean, I live a life that people pay money and buy popcorn and go sit and watch on the screen. I'm in that movie.
So, living that kind of life, what does your typical day look like?
Oh gosh, I mean, when I tell you, my day can be as simple as writing a book and sitting in my garden office in Florida and having my wife come out about nine times and sit in my lap and just hold me and say, I love you so much. And share having a meal with the children and the most normal thing you could imagine to taking a plane and landing in Nice, France, and getting on a helicopter and going after I checked in at the Negresco when they say, Welcome back, Mr. Dohrmann. And then going on the helicopter and landing in Monaco, not that far away, outside on one of the big yachts. And sitting in the back with the host, who's world famous and has the head of state with them, and people are around in white suits. And if someone takes out a cigarette, 15 people come over with a thing and come right back again. And that's a movie. And we're discussing how to reform the economics of the nation. Or we're discussing how to reform growing that company in a kind of hypergrowth that would be impossible without those conversations. And I'm helicoptered back and then fly to the head of state in another nation and meet him at the Capitol and have a private dinner. Always off press, no paparazzi, very under the table, no leaks to press, no discussions, because what we're talking about is intellectual property, very solid solutions to their problems that they'll take credit for political capital. And I'll never come up as the engineer behind it because I was paid by them to advise them and give them the cogs in that wheel that they could use for political capital. And that's the purpose of it. It's not to get credit. It's to have millions of lives affected. And so then you'll go back and have the little life with a book on the beach in Florida, watching the waves, and your wife saying, you have to come in, you have to come in. And I don't really want to get up and go in the water, but I have to, because she needs to get her legs around me and just float and look at the water and the horizon and whisper in my ear, I love you so much, Daddy. I love you so much. Once again. So that's the little life and the big life.
I really like that. Thank you for sharing it.
Well, we get 5 CEO spaces a year. You know, I wrote the book, How to Prosper and Super Change. So the age we live in is super change. There's more challenge for you all because of the changes and the speed and the velocity. We thought it was going to slow down, become normal again. I'll tell you, it's not slowing down. It's just speeding up. What we have to do is calm down to catch up. We have to calm down to catch up, but you have to remain current. And currency is the new capital for leadership, whether that's the C-suite in business or political capital. You have to remain current. And to remain current, you have to have a process. You either go to Wharton and go to several of their refreshers, or you go to CEO space, but you find your CEO space-like environment. And one of the things CEO space was designed by me for was to keep me current. So every 60 days, there's an event with the mentors that run companies and the coaches that teach the Fortune company board chairman. Those coaches are bringing fresh to quarter, whatever the new changes are, new president, new politics, new policies, bringing them in and telling you how to react and what to do and stay ahead of it. Then next quarter, it's a whole new group of trainers from a whole new group of Fortune companies, and they will keep you current. So I invest in keeping current. And so in 5 of those a year, I'm sitting in those. I'm working with those mentors one-on-one. And when I have a challenge, I make a challenge list before I go. And the same mentors that are helping my customers are helping me take my challenge list as a leader and take everything off that. The only thing I don't get solved is what I forgot to write down. It's that good. So I love that. I think staying current is really something you want to start thinking about for reading, what you're watching, and what you're putting in your software here, because super change is ongoing. And if you get left behind, you will be left out. You will become irrelevant. And to hold relevancy today, you've got to have an adventure as a lifelong learner and remain current. The new education is not a degree from Harvard. The new education is, are you a brain that can learn at a faster speed and unlearn and relearn? So you have to learn, unlearn, and relearn at a level that your fathers, 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 and mothers never had to do. But you have to remain current.
Berny, you know, throughout the life, we usually come across people who inspire us. Do you have any personal inspirations, people that inspire yourself?
Well, I mean, you know, I grew up with Napoleon Hill of Think and Grow Rich, where I was on his lap. I never knew a time where I wasn't. I was there when Zig Ziglar, who's passed now, was 22 years old and started with my father's company, Earl Nightingale. And I grew up with Jack Kennedy and Martin Luther King and Walt Disney. And so when you say, who's inspired you? And then you look forward into the, you know, everybody that was of the past great thought leaders of our time, my father coached them. They were in my home. Today, when you talk about the greatest thought leaders of all time, we just lost Wayne Dyer. But I've coached Brian Tracy, Jack Canfield, Mark Hansen, John Gray, Tony Robbins, the folks that lead the thought leader movement, you know, have for the majority, rotated around CEO space and or Cy World, my father's firm. And between them, I know them all and I've been part of them. So, you know, I think that if I had to say one thing to all of you, it would go back to stepping out of the barbecue pit when we had to go to bed, the 9 children in my family and the 20 neighbors that had come over. Because in that time in 1955, when I was 7, Walt Disney was at the barbecue pit with my father. And he knelt down with his glass that he was drinking from, holding it because I could remember the ice moving when he was talking. And he knelt down. We were on stairs above him in a semicircle. And he looked at the children with the firelight reflecting on them. And he said, "Children," that warm summer evening in San Francisco Bay Area, he said, "I want you to always remember one thing about Disneyland and building it and making it happen. Is all the people that told me you could never do it. You're successful in your film business. Why risk everything? Why maybe go bankrupt? Why spend all that money? You don't know if it'll work. And I told you something, and I want you children to remember one thing that I've told you for the rest of your life." We were all leaning forward and paying attention. And he said, "I told you that if you children could dream it," I didn't say if you had the right education. I didn't say if you had the money. I didn't say if you had the right connections. I didn't say if you were born in the right neighborhood. I didn't say any of that, children, because it's not true. What I said to you, and you never forget it, is if you could dream it, you can do it. And don't you ever forget that as you go to bed. And Dad made us run to bed, but I never forgot that. That was huge. And then Les Brown, with his 4 cancers, maybe an unknown time to still be with us. And Les Brown's famous story is also so big in my life to complete what Walt said. When the 4 stadiums, as filled as you can imagine, 35,000 people, Les says, as he closes that meeting, and they're just changed, and he goes, "So where is the greatest wealth for you? When you want to go find wealth, where is it?" And it's quiet as a pin drop. "Let me tell you where it is. It's in the cemetery. Go to any cemetery in any city or county and walk through the cemetery, and I'll tell you the greatest wealth in the world is there, because that's where all the dreams that have never been done are buried. And those dreams are screaming like ghosts to those that are in the ground. Only you could have given me life. Only you could have made my purpose come about to serve others. Only you, because it came from God that I came to you, could be brought forth and made manifest. And you squandered me and you allowed me to die with you." And I'm saying, if you want to be in the cemetery with your ghost screaming at you, then you know what you have to do, which is nothing. But if you've been changed by me today, there isn't one of your dreams that will be buried with you in that cemetery. Now that's powerful and motivating. And if those two things could grab your life, go do your dreams. That's God's capital. And that's the most important deposit that you put in your ATM account of your lifetime. Your dreams. And I'll tell you, doing your dreams, it's what gives you thrilling lives. Don't let anything dissuade you, stop you, block you, and get circles of people, 3 to 5 or so, that support you in doing your dreams, and remove circles that don't.
Berny, there was a lot of stuff already said, but to make it a little bit more structured out of your experience and wisdom, what would be the top 3 tips and strategies you could share with us today for our entrepreneurial and business journey?
Well, back to CEO space. I mean, we've helped more entrepreneurs and more projects and dreams and brands to be successful than any place in the world. A second grade school teacher making a product in her bathroom, later selling it for numbers you can't imagine, as airborne, the allergy and cold medication you have for your children, starting chicken soup for the soul, or green glotter, the mophead, or piano wizard, the educational product for children, or tow truck in a box for every automotive, car trunk in the world. We, launch more brands that no one believed could be successful and break records with them. So when you go forward and you own a business, the only reason you're not growing as fast as you want is because you have weak plans, weak teams, and you don't have the resources to go all the way. As soon as you get stronger plans, stronger teams, and that's two or three people, you can do everything you want to do. The other reason is capital. Capital works harder than you do. So if I could advertise for 2 years and advertise to your core market and put public relations, so there are articles, news, there are reports that your core market is seeing all the time when they're seeing the ads, you would get more customers than your labors could ever get. So getting capital in your company pulls the slingshot back so we can hit the bullseye of your growth. We need to pull the slingshot back with capital. Capital is not hard. They changed all the laws just recently so you could raise capital and raise it all over the world more easily than any generation or time. It isn't hard, it's just new. So I highly recommend you dive in and learn about how to raise capital and become masterful at it, put capital behind your business, and then use the capital to get better plans, better teams, and you'll go all the way because you already have the capital, which is the resources to be unstoppable. So if you follow that model and those sequences, you're going to do a lot better than if you are in a rat in a maze doing the same things you did before, thinking you're going to have massively different results next year. So this computer needs a download of skills you don't have now to go to the next level. Invest in that. You need social capital. You need some connections you don't have in social capital to take you to the next level. Invest in that and do it right away. And then your lifetime, which is coming out of an hourglass, and you can't stop the flow or the pace because your wealth is your lifetime. And that will help you use your lifetime with much more effectiveness and efficiency than going the way that you did before and not changing and improving dramatically how every use of the future lifetime is going to be better than it was yesterday. And in that improvement of you, yesterday is already too late.
Thank you. And what sort of resources could you recommend to the person to make their life easier?
Well, are we talking about business? Or are we talking about personal?
Business, entrepreneurship. So whoever is, in the business or starting the business or maybe already in the business but needs to make their life easier.
Well, go on Google and just search top-ranked business conferences and go to the top-ranked business conferences that come out. In technology, I'd definitely go to HubSpot's annual meeting and I'd move your database and your management to HubSpot. I think they do a better job than Infusionsoft. I think they do such a better job than Salesforce. I think Salesforce has lost it. And I'm saying customer service, I know they have. And HubSpot smothers you. But, we all have to manage our data and get good reports so we can be intimate with our customer. Get current. Stay current with those conferences. Go to at least 3 to 5 a year. I found when I reduced the number of conferences I went to, my income dropped. When I increased the number of conferences I went to, my income soared. And it really has to do with social capital and who you're meeting at the conferences. And so it's not just the uploads, it's what you're, doing in meeting. Try to go to more interactive conferences where there's networking advertised and promoted, not just lectures. But I would go to, 5 or 6 conferences a year, and it'll grow your business. Don't be too busy to grow, In other words, I'm too busy to grow. And don't do that. In other words, You have to go to know. And so give yourself the opportunity to constantly be downloading this and pick the business top ranked offerings that are out there. And CEO space is one, but it's by far not the only one. There are really, really good conferences out there, and we recommend a lot of them, and go to them and pick the one that you want and enjoy it.
Thank you for sharing that, Berny. Berny, I come across quite a lot of people who say that at some point of life, they came across a book that changed their life. Did you have such a book? And if you did, what was it?
Well, I have books all the time that I'm reading that, you know, I probably read seven a week. So what's my latest one? I'm reading one on cyber psychology. That's the name of the book. And it's showing that the way that we exist online is changing us, and that we act differently online than we do when we're with each other like we are now. And so they also give the supposition that once we go online, it is a place. We have placed our consciousness in another place, which is why we can't hear people say dinner's ready or anything else, because we're totally in another place doing other things. And so how do you stay current in the biggest change that's happened, the massive technology coming into our lives and making us change who we are as people, who we are as a society? We running this big experiment. We don't have any reports, guidances, or anything else. There wasn't cyber. And by the way, this cyber psychologist is a woman out of Ireland, and she is being asked to be in crime scenes all over the world, because one of the sidebars was, if we thought this was going to help all of our normal brains and sane brains and help us so much, did we ever think about what it would do to the community that was criminal and deviant and bad brains? Sexually deviant, violent deviant, crime deviant. And that's why we have the deep web, the dark web that they live in. We don't even see. We're in the surface web on the top. And I'm just saying, you know, reading about these things and remaining current in them, I love it. I mean, maybe some would rather just watch mindless, endless movies, but I would rather, you know, soak this up. And I love it and enjoy it. So, you know, when I say, is there one book over all of them? As you know, the book that I treasure the most is one I wrote, and that's called Redemption, the Cooperation Revolution. So I think the biggest personal growth, human growth going on, is to identify that competitive thought is the one virus infecting humanity. And that it is toxic, it is evil, and it has got no redeeming features. And that as a spirit, when you die, you're in total cooperation, collaboration, you're in one big collab. You can be anywhere you want, you can immediately see each other's thoughts and share each other's experiences, you're in a collab. Down here, we are dog eat dog, beat each other in the ground, screw each other before thou art screwed unto. And I'm saying, it's insane. And so competition is a form of insanity. And once humanity sees it and starts waking up to it, and millions are, and they're getting cooperative and collaborative. And so I think the cooperative revolution is the most important movement of humankind in modern, live lifestyles. And to the extent you can become more cooperative in your home space, your workspace, your community, your state and nation, I think you change the world. You'll definitely change your world. And so if I had to say to everybody, read one book, I don't like to be a commercial, but Think and Grow Rich is a long time ago. I'd read, you know, Cooperation, you know, Redemption, the Cooperation Revolution, if you want to become part of the revolution. You know, you have to read Think and Grow Rich. It's my all-time favorite. And Outwitting the Devil by Napoleon Hill, that he wrote later. Those two you know, I'd put them at the top of my, who else, you know, someone else wrote a book and you treasure it more than anything. I like Course in Miracles, you know, if I said my top three. So Course in Miracles, Think and Grow Rich, and Outwitting the Devil. My dad had Course in Miracles, was one of its first certified trainers, and he carried it with him wherever he went for all of his life. And he grew up with Napoleon Hill, but in his casket, his hands are folded over A Course in Miracles.
Thank you for that, Berny. I always like to ask, just for fun, where do you come up with your best ideas?
From there. Ideas are God's capital. They're coming in a never-ending download. And so if you're Mozart, it'll be music. If you're a hairdresser making new sauces for our barbecue, which a friend of mine is doing, then the download is for the recipe. If you're in a technology and you're Steven Jobs, God rest his soul, is going to be, you know, the new tech that is coming out. If it's a art, if it's a service, whatever it is for you, you're getting solutions to solve a problem for your family. And so I tell you again, stop being so busy. Pause. Stop. Give yourself quiet time whenever you need a solution. Tap yourself here. And remember, your head energy is 25% of your intelligence, and that your intelligence is your heart energy. That's your 75%. Tap yourself here and go calmly over a beverage when you're drinking your favorite beverage, and say to yourself, what do you think? What's the solution? And then allow 72 hours. It'll hit you like lightning. This energy always hits you like lightning. And then you know the answer is right, and it's a solution that you needed, and use it. And then be grateful. Turn your head back and go, thank you, in whatever faith or religion you have. And if I could give you a mantra to live by, celebrate all diversity. Everybody's politics, everybody's religion, celebrate how they think. Celebrate it. Never punish it. You're not trying to convert them. And it's interesting, the tapestry. Who cares if it's Sunni, Shiite, Wahhabi? Tell me about your food. Tell me about your song. Tell me about your dress. Tell me about your sport. Tell me about your game. Tell me how you worship God. Isn't it interesting, children? And five-year-olds all get it. We have to celebrate each other because we're still all worshiping Allah. Who cares that we do it differently? That's the color Allah wants. That's our color. Isn't it wonderful? Everybody's coloring books a little different. Isn't that great? And so let's worship in the way that we worship and celebrate it and stop because of politics between nations, etc. Celebrate culture, diversity, and respect it. And if the more we cooperate, the more we're going to flourish. The more we compete, the more we're going to perish. So it's really the core fundamental. But your lives at home become so happy if your home life is cooperative, because you don't have escalations, you don't have fights, you have a home life that is like paradise, and you have to work at that. And the reason you don't is because of competitive thought form. It isn't what's going on and the symptoms. And if you endlessly work on the symptoms, the virus won because it's invisible. If your life is blue screening all the time and you have to reboot your life in your fifth divorce, you might want to look at the cause, and it's not you. So just remember, this virus was loaded on your computer by people you don't know and can't remember. And it's a program. And once you want to get rid of a slow operating computer and it's not working right and it's rebooting all the time, you have to know that you've got a virus. First thing, if you don't know you have a virus, you can't get rid of it. You have a virus, and it's competitive thought. And once you get that that thought's not what you want, especially in your home life, then you start to both talk about it and say, we're going to come at everything cooperatively, we're going to do things differently, and we're not going to have competitive escalations. And you will change your life for your children and for your home life. Start there and then get it in the workspace. Let's start there. So you have the paradise at home instead of a war zone.
Thank you for that. Bernie, you're a very successful business person and you live a dream life of many people. You got it all. So what is next for you? What's your next big aim, dream, goal? And if there is somebody who listens today and could potentially help you get there in some way, who would it be?
Well, we're looking for a $100 million partner who wants to put $100 million into CEO space and will take it public so they make a lot of money. And we have plans for them when they do that. If they want to see a legacy for what they're investing in family wealth for entrepreneurialism massively reaching. So what we want to end up with is at the convention center. Here, where we live, is in Florida, to see six ballrooms with 5,000 people and 50,000 coming on the weekends and be the largest entrepreneurial event that goes on in the world and allow all that social capital and networking. And the money gives us the advertising to do that. And then to build that with the public money so that that model. We call it a wagon wheel model, where the faculty teach and then move to the next ballroom of 5,000. And when we network, there's 30,000 networking. We want to have that in Africa, South America, the EU, and Asia. So a member can come to the founder forum in America, but if they want to open products in Asia, they go to the Asia forum. If they want to open products in the EU, they go to the EU forum and get all their contacts. If they want to open products in Africa, they go to the Africa Forum and they get to go to them all for free for life and circulate through them. And that'll change the tax base, nations, employment. It'll be one of the biggest contributions our partner could make with their lifetime. So, we're looking for that. I mean, that would accelerate greatly what we're going to do anyway. So, if you have access to a family wealth fund that would like a legacy position, and there are lots of them, there's one gentleman, he's dying of cancer, and he's got billions, and he'd be perfect, but we don't want to ask him when he's suffering and dying, and all the family want to control that money. We don't want to get into the politics of that. We want to have a sweetness of a sovereign nation fund. Or a personal wealth fund with wealth fund managers, make a good deal with a 30-year-old institution, and we'll partner into a public company together. So
Brilliant.
that's next for us.
Awesome. Bernie, before we wrap up, is there anything else you would like to share or advice to a listener today?
Well, it's back to the dreams of Walt Disney. I'm asked all the time, why do you do it? At your time of life, why do you travel to Romania, India, Israel, and you're away from your family so much and you travel so hard? And it reminds me of last Christmas when a single mom about your age had borrowed the money to come to CO Space with her super glued product that was put together very rough with super glue to show us a dream she had. She didn't have it patented, protected. She didn't have it manufactured or packaged. And her last money she borrowed, it was to go to our place. And she stood up in this last December Christmas program with tears streaming down her face, holding her product up, talking about how from that decision, she learned how to raise the money. From that decision, she got on home shopping and sold out. From that decision, she got on QVC and sold out over and over and over. From that decision, she got in Kroger's department stores. Then she got in the major chains. Then she got in Walmart, all from CO Space. Then she got her manufacturing that could keep up. Then she got the credit lines that could keep up. And now she has 15 store chains all over the world asking for her product, Green Glider. And she's showing to the camera where it says, special thanks to CO Space. right on the label. And she said, I know it's so small that most people won't read it, but I read it in every run. And I'm always like this, crying to gratitude. And she goes, now I'm going to all the other chains and making that happen. And I'm not in an apartment anymore. And as a single mom, my kid's in private school. And I'm not stopping because that's plan A. And I'm a CEO space graduate and I'm president of Green Glider International. And there is no plan B because this is what I do and I'm not doing anything else. And she got a standing ovation and came over to the podium and high-fived me. And I said to her as that high-five was going on, you're why I do it. So I do it for that next single mom that can give that kind of share and example. And her life is so changed. And I have tens of thousands of Tanyas, tens of thousands, helping more entrepreneurs than any single person that's alive today. What does that feel like? It's my business church. And my miracle is you when you do your dream. So how good is that? I am confident that Napoleon Hill, my Uncle Nappy, and Uncle Walt will be very proud when I high-five them at the end.
Thank you so much, Berny. Thanks for today. Thanks for sparing the time. Really appreciate it. For anyone who wants to get in touch, what's the best way to find you?
Well, cospace.net is easy and plenty of films and lots of information. And you can always email me at my name, Berny Dohrmann. Just like it sounds, B-E-R-N-Y, and it's right on the website, cospace.net. And you just email me at Gmail. No space, all lowercase, BernyDohrmann@gmail.com. Couldn't be easier. I'm very open, as you can see, and so I return all my email myself, not staff. So just bullet point it, tell me what you need or want, and I'll help you.
Thank you very much, Berny. Really appreciate it. Thank you for your time. I really hope to see you sometimes in person again, and you know that would be just amazing. But it's been an incredible interview. Thank you for that.
Thank you.